The scripture passage today is taken from 1 John chapter 2, verses 1 to 6, and the reading will be from the English Standard Version of the Bible. My little children, I'm writing these things to you so that you may not sin. But if anyone does sin, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ, the righteous. He is the propitiation for our sins, and not for ours only, but also for the sins of the whole world. And by this we know that we have come to know him if we keep his commandments. Whosoever says, I know him, but does not keep his commandment, is a liar, and the truth is not in him. But whoever keeps his word, in him truly the love of God is perfected. By this we may know that we are in him. Whoever says he abides in him ought to walk in the same way in which he walked. May the Lord bless the public reading of his holy word. Today's speaker is Pastor David Wong.
Very good morning. Excuse me for a while, I think I've left part of my sermon notes on the bench. We all grew up with different ideas and views about sin. And much depends on our religious background as well as on the way we were raised. A friend of mine from Kenya in Africa was raised to believe that there were two angels sitting on his shoulders, one on his left and the other on his right. The angel on his left records all the bad things he did, and the angel on his right records all the good things he did. So as he grew up, his goal each day was to make sure that the good he did outbalanced the bad he had done. He told me that every time he did something good, he would turn his head to the right and say, write it down. But when he did something bad, he would keep very quiet so as not to wake up the angel on his left. But as he grew up, there was always this fear that the good he did would never make up for the bad he had done. And who knows what would happen on Judgment Day when his good deeds and bad deeds are added up. Which side would tip the balance against the other? Would the angel on the right save him, or would the angel on his left condemn him? Now, if indeed that there were two angels sitting on your shoulders this past week, what kind of reports do you think they would submit at the end of the week? Are we aware each time when we commit a sin, a wrong, in thought, in word, or in action, do we consciously avoid a sin and obey God's commandments? And how successful are we in doing so? Today we're looking at a very short passage from a letter by the Apostle John to the church. It's all about sin and sinning, about knowing God and keeping his commandments. Let us ask the Lord to teach us the truth from his word. Let us just pause and pray. O Christ, our atoning sacrifice and advocate, you died for our sins, and you defend us when we sin. Show us how we may keep your word, abide in you, and walk as you walk, so that we may know you, so that the love of God may be perfected in us. For your name's sake, we pray. Amen. We've just read a short portion from a letter written by John, one of Jesus' 12 disciples. John was now an elderly man, probably in his 80s, maybe even his 90s. He was writing to the churches, and he calls them little children, partly because he's older than they, and partly because he loves them like his own family. Now, the six verses we read may be divided into two parts. The first Two verses, if you have been attentive, you will find the word sin or sins mentioned four times. And in the last four verses, you have the words no mentioned four times and keep mentioned three times. So this passage is about avoiding sin on the one hand and knowing God by keeping his commandments on the other. John begins with these words, "My little children, I'm writing these things to you so that you may not sin." What are these things? What does John mean by that you may not sin? How will these things that he's writing to his readers keep them from sinning? Does he expect his readers not to sin? Is that possible? Well, let's try to answer these questions. Firstly, what are these things? John must be referring to what he's just written in the preceding verses, which is found in chapter 1, at the end of chapter 1, because the word sin is also found there. And obviously, this theme of sin is running through John's mind. So these things he's writing must be about sin and sinning, because at the end of chapter 1, he says, if we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves. If we confess our sins, he, that is God, is faithful and just to forgive us our sins. If we say we have not sinned, we make God a liar. Now notice how these three sentences begin with if. If we say we have no sin, we end up deceiving ourselves. If we confess our sins, we end up being forgiven. If we say we have not sinned when we have indeed sinned, then we make God a liar and a deceiver. Now, immediately after making these three statements, John says, I'm writing these things to you so that you may not sin. So he's continuing along the line of sin and sinning. And he anticipates the questions that his readers would be asking. How can we avoid falling into sin? And what do we do when we fall into sin? I believe these are questions that we should also be asking. How can we avoid falling into sin? And what should we do when we fall into sin? Now, before I look at the way John answers those questions, let's look at what he means by sin. What does he mean by sin? Well, we look further down the passage. He refers to three kinds of sin: the desires of the flesh, the desires of the eyes, and the pride in possessions. In the King James Version, the familiar words are the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, and the pride of life. He tells us that these are things that do not come from the Father, they come from the world. So we may define sin as anything that is not of God. It does not come from God, but from somewhere else. Sin is anything that is out of character with God. It is not what God would do or would approve that it be done. It is not what God is. It's not who God is. So the three kinds of sin mentioned here are all not of God. Well, we may call the first category of sin lust. The second category, covetousness. And the third category, pride. Now notice that all the sins, the sin of lust, the sin of covetousness, the sin of pride, they're all sins committed inwardly. It's committed in the mind, it's committed in the heart. But they are also expressed outwardly. Lust leads to adultery and all kinds of sexual sins and addictions. Covetousness leads to cheating and stealing. And pride leads to the abuse of power, the loss of temper and violence. I have an outline in the bulletin, and it's a slightly different outline. It's not the usual outline with point 1, 2, 3, and subpoints A, B, C. I've done it in the form of a map. And you will see right in the center of it is the word sin. This is the theme of the passage. Everything John writes in these six verses relates to this theme of sin. But look at the word above the word sin. We have Christ, or Jesus Christ the righteous. In verse 1, Jesus Christ the righteous. Now the title the righteous is important because it means that Jesus Christ is without sin. We are unrighteous because we have done wrong, but Christ is righteous because he has done no wrong. And what has Christ, the righteous, done as far as sin is concerned? Now, two things are mentioned here. Firstly, he's our advocate when we sin, verse 1. Secondly, he's the propitiation for our sins, verse 2. And when we look at those two words, one vivid way of understanding what Christ has done is to think of him as someone coming in between us and our sin. Someone coming in between us and the God whom we have offended by our sin. You see, when we sin, we offend God and his character. And here God is called the Father, the first person of the Trinity. Our relationship with him is broken because we have incurred the wrath of a holy God. How can that relationship be restored? Now, this is where Christ comes in. He came and offered himself as a propitiation, or in another translation, an atoning sacrifice. Now, what does it mean? What does propitiation mean? What does atoning sacrifice mean? It means that Christ had turned aside God's wrath from us and took it upon himself. He took the penalty of our sins upon himself and so satisfied the holiness and justice of God. And that is what we sang just now in the song, where it says, when the sinless Savior died, God the just is satisfied. When the sinless Savior died, God the just is satisfied. And that is how our relationship with God can be restored. God is holy, we are not. God is righteous, we are not. The only way for a relationship to exist between us and God is for a sacrifice, an atoning sacrifice, a propitiation to be made. Let me go back to my friend from Kenya. Remember how he was brought up to believe there were two angels sitting on his shoulders, one recording all the bad deeds and the other recording all his good deeds? I wonder whether it was like this before we came to know Christ. We try to do good to offset what we have done wrong. But we know that it does not work that way. I remember once I was driving, I was in a hurry, and I went through a red light. Immediately, I looked around to see whether there was any police car around or whether I had been caught by a camera. Well, I slowed down my driving and told myself I must stop at the next set of traffic lights if it is red. So for the rest of the journey, I stopped whenever the light was red and even when it was amber, because I want to obey all the traffic lights. And I did so for 6 or 7 times for the rest of the day. But did I go home thinking that all my so-called good deeds have offset my one bad deed? If I should get a summon from the police, do I tell them, but I did obey the traffic light 7 times that day, and that should more than make up for the one offense that I committed? Of course, you know that the law doesn't work that way. Now, even if the angel sitting on your left shoulder writes down one bad deed you did, you have to pay for it. That is why the gospel is such good news. Yeah, when my Kenyan friend became a Christian, he stopped believing in the two angels. He believed in Christ. He believes in Christ who has dealt with all his sins once and for all. He knew that all the good he did in life could never make up for the sin he committed. But the penalty for all those sins had been paid for by the one sacrifice of Christ on the cross, and that sacrifice paid not only for my sins, your sins, but the sins of the whole world. That's the value of that sacrifice, the atoning sacrifice, the propitiation. But not only is Christ a propitiation, an atoning sacrifice, he's also an advocate. Because not only did Christ pay for our sins once and for all on the cross, he continues to intervene each time we sin. So we come to the second word, advocate. The word in the original language is paraclete, or someone who comes alongside. It's a word that Jesus used of the Holy Spirit. If you remember in John 14 to 16, Jesus talks about someone who had come, another comforter, another counselor, another defender, advocate, meaning that Jesus himself was the first advocate, the Holy Spirit being the second. Each time we sin, we incur God's wrath. And Christ steps in to plead on our behalf so that forgiveness may be extended to us. You know, when John says, I write these things to you so that you may not sin, he knows full well that we will sin. Because immediately after that, in fact, almost in the next breath, he writes, but if anyone does sin. So he's saying, don't sin, but if you do fall into sin, this is what is going to happen. You see, John doesn't teach sinless perfection. We can never be perfectly free from sin. We strive towards it. We avoid sin, but we can never attain a state where we are perfectly sinless. Not at least in this life. Not at least not in this life, not in this world, not in this body. So what do we do when we fall into sin? Well, John already tells us in chapter 1, he says we should confess our sins. Confessing means we first acknowledge that we are sinners and we have sinned. It also means naming the sin that's committed and accepting full responsibility for it. Later on, James will tell us that we should confess our sins to one another, James chapter 5, verse 16. Though John does not say this specifically here, he has earlier talked about walking in the light as God is in the light and having fellowship with one another, John chapter 1, verse 7. You remember Pastor Dave spoke on this passage, and he calls this truthful fellowship. Truthful fellowship, when we open up to one another and we become transparent and truthful with each other. And that includes sharing with one another about our struggles, our failures. And later on in John chapter 2, John will return to the same theme of walking in the light, loving our brother and abiding in the light, verse 10. Now some of us think of confession as a private thing. We talk to God privately. But there's a place for confessing our sins to one another and opening up to one another. And we are confident in doing this because Christ comes alongside us. He's our advocate. When we are truly sorry for our sins, Christ intervenes. He takes our side with us. He defends us from any accusation, and he frees us from any guilt. I have on several occasions been called up to meet someone in high authority. You know, when you meet up with people in the powers that be, it can be quite intimidating and frightening. Well, I've been on those occasions gone to plead for a case or to request for a favor. And on such occasions, it's always good to have someone with you who knows the people in authority. Once the person I went with told me this. He said, Pastor David, just let me do the talking. No need for you to say anything. Well, that's very reassuring. Another time, the person assured me, he said, don't worry, we are meeting someone who used to report to me when I worked in this department. You know, it's reassuring to have individuals as our advocates who are like this. But you know, Christ is our best advocate. He's the best advocate we can ever have. He's Jesus Christ, the righteous. He's the one who has done no wrong, and he cannot do any wrong. He pleads our case, and he always wins. He always prevails. And we don't have to say much. We let him do the talking. He will say it for us. So in every way, we are covered. Now, not only are we told that God has done something about our sin by sending Christ to be our atoning sacrifice, we're told of what Christ would do if we ever fall into sin by being our advocate. We may sum up by saying that with regard to sin, we are covered back and front. Looking back, we see the cross on which Christ offered himself as an atoning sacrifice, as our propitiation. Looking forward, we see Christ as our defender and advocate when we fall into sin. We are safe. We are really safe. But does it mean that we can therefore sin freely? Because all our sins have been forgiven once and for all, atoned, paid for. Does it mean we can sin freely because every time we sin, we can be forgiven through the intervention of our advocate? Not so. Because John goes on to the second part of our passage. And again, a few key words here are know and keep. While Christ dominates the first part of our passage, we have commandments coming in the second part. And we are told, you can either keep the commandments or you can break them. You can keep the commandments or you can choose not to keep them. By the same token, you can either know God or you can choose not to know him, or you do not know him. And John tells us someone who says, I know God, but he does not keep God's commandments, he is a liar. Is it keeping the commandments and knowing God go together? You cannot have one without the other. You cannot be breaking God's commandments, sinning against God, and claim that you know him. It's like a husband who once tells his pastor, I prayed about the divorce and I have the peace of God to go ahead with it. The wife does not feel the same way. She says, sure, he has the peace, but I will have the pieces. So with regard to sin, there are two groups of people. On one side are those who acknowledge their sins. They acknowledge that they are sinners. On the other hand, there are those who refuse to acknowledge their sins, refuse to confess their sins, refuse to keep the commandments, and refuse to admit that they had sinned. Well, John tells us that they are liars. So if you look at the outline, the center of it is sin, and on one side is a sinner, and we are sinners. We sin, we admit we're sinners, and we sin because we are sinners. On the other side is a liar. A liar is someone who does not do what commands but claims to know God. He sins, but he refuses to admit it. John tells us that he is a liar and the truth is not in him. When we admit we are sinners, we confess our sins. Christ comes alongside us as our advocate and defender. But when we do wrong, break God's commandments, and refuse to admit it, Christ stands against us as an accuser. Would you like to have an advocate or an accuser? And I'm sure you'd rather have Christ as your defending lawyer rather than your prosecuting lawyer. Let's look at the last word in these keywords now, like commandments. John tells us, we know that we have come to know him if we keep his commandments. In fact, that's what Jesus said to the disciples on one occasion. He says, if anyone loves me, he will keep my word. And my Father will love him, and we will come to him and make our home in him. If anyone loves me, he will keep my word. He will keep my commandments. Knowing God, loving God, must include obeying God, keeping his commandments. We cannot claim to know God, we cannot claim to love God, if we are consciously disobeying him. If we do that, God calls us a liar. Now, this point may be helpful for us to make a distinction between falling into sin and persisting in sin. It's one thing to fall into sin and get up again, but it's another thing to persist in sin and refuse to get out of it. You know, in chapter 1, John has earlier written, if we walk in the light as he is in the light, we have fellowship with one another, and the blood of Jesus, his Son, cleanses us from our sin. It is when we choose to walk in the light that we find forgiveness of sin. Now, from time to time, we may stray into darkness. We may turn to the dark side. We may yield to temptation. We may fall into sin. But when we are convicted that we have gone off track, we confess our sin, and Christ, our advocate, comes alongside us, defends us, restores us, and we come back to the light. And the blood of Jesus cleanses us from all sin. But if we persist in our sinful way, we choose a path we know is a path of darkness and a path of disobedience to God, then we are persisting in our sin. We are persisting in darkness. And John later on writes about this. He said, whoever says he's in the light and hates his brother is still in darkness. Whoever hates his brother is in darkness and walks in darkness. If there's hatred, if there's lust, if there's covetousness, if there's pride, and you refuse to confess, then you persist in darkness. So it is important for us to choose to come to the light rather than choose to remain in the darkness. How do we come to the light? And how do we stay in the light? Well, the key word here is keep. Keep his commandments. We align our life with God's will, and we know that we know him when we walk as Jesus walks. We abide in him, and we find the love of God perfected in us. And those keywords are all there. keep, know, abide, walk. Now, it may sound like a lot of things for us to do. To know God, to keep His commandments, to abide in Him, to walk as He walked. But remember this, that God has done it first. He has done it already. Before He asked us to do anything, He has done what He could do for us. He has taken care of the punishment of our sins, all our sins. Christ, our propitiation, our atoning sacrifice. He has also promised us an advocate when we need help. He's standing by to intervene, to come alongside us. We are not on our own. He's there for us, coming alongside us, defending us, protecting us, bringing us back to the light. So we are told that whoever keeps His word, God's word, in Him truly the love of God is perfected. And the last thing I want to say, the love of God is perfected when we keep God's commandments. Now what does he mean? What does John mean? How is the keeping of God's commandments related to the perfecting of God's love? Later on in John chapter, 1 John chapter 4, John will write about the perfecting of God's love. Verses 7 and 8 of chapter 4, he says, by this is love perfected with us, so that we may have confidence for the day of judgment. There is no fear in love, but perfect love casts out fear. There is no fear in love, but perfect love cast out fear. Now, if we take these verses from chapter 4 and put it together with the verses we have read from chapter 2, we understand what John is saying. He's saying that love is the opposite of fear. Why do we avoid sin? Why do we keep God's commandments? Is it out of fear? Out of fear of punishment? Out of the fear of going to hell? So for the person who believes in Christ, he knows that his sins are forgiven. That fear is taken away. For someone who believes in Christ, he knows that when he sins, Christ will stand with him and sees that he's cleared and forgiven. That fear is taken away. He's no longer fearful. So what has taken the place of fear? It's love. God shows his love by sending Christ to be an atoning sacrifice for us. Christ shows his love by coming alongside us to be our advocate. We obey God, we keep His commandments because we love Him. And we love Him because He first loved us. We are responding to the love He has shown. So when we hear God say to us, keep my commandments. No, we don't want to do it because we have to do it, because we are fearful if we don't do it, something will happen to us. When God says, keep my commandments, we want to keep His commandments. We do it not because we have to do it, but because we want to do it. And this is when God's love is perfected in us, because love has taken over fear in our hearts. Let me close with a familiar story from the Gospel of John. You know that John is one of Jesus' disciples, and he saw many things during the ministry of Jesus. He recorded for us those stories, those accounts in the gospel. Now, John tells us of someone who was once told by Jesus, do not sin. Do not sin anymore. Let me ask you, if Jesus were to tell you today, do not sin, stop it, give it up, would you do it? You know, Jesus once gave this command to a woman. A woman was caught in adultery. Jesus said to this woman, he said, do not sin. Do not sin anymore. What happened? She was caught in the act of adultery. The religious leaders dragged her, and we can imagine she was probably half naked. The religious leaders dragged her to Jesus, threw her at his feet, and asked Jesus, this woman is caught in the act of adultery. According to the law of Moses, she is to be stoned to death. What do you say? What do you say? Now, those of you who know the account, you'll remember what happened. Jesus bent over, and he started writing on the sand. We're not told what he wrote, but he ignored their question. The religious leaders asked him again. According to the law of Moses, she is to be stoned to death. What do you say? Finally, Jesus stood up and he said, let him who is without sin among you be the first to throw a stone at her. And after saying this, Jesus bent over again. He bent down to the ground and he continued writing in the sand. Again, we are not told what he wrote, but he waited. Then we read that one by one, the crowd walked away. You can imagine the scene. You can imagine the sound of the stone falling to the ground as one by one they dropped their stone on the ground. And you can almost hear the shuffling of the feet as they walked away, according to John, beginning with the older ones, followed by the younger ones, until finally no one was left. No one was left except for Jesus and the woman. It was then Jesus stood up and said to the woman, woman, where are your accusers? Has no one condemned you? And I can imagine the woman looking around her, and she said, no one, Lord. And there she stood with Jesus. Jesus, the only one without sin, the only one who could take a stone and cast it at her. What did Jesus do? Jesus looked at the woman, and I'm sure she looked at her in her eye, and she said, neither do I condemn you. And that is when Jesus gave the commandment, go, and from now on, sin no more. Now, I'm sure John was there, and John saw everything. Now he writes to us, and he tells us, I'm writing these things to you so that you may not sin. But if you sin, you have Jesus as an advocate. You have Jesus who will come between you and your accusers, who will come between you and your sin. And he will say, where are your accusers? Neither do I condemn you. How can you not obey him? And he says, go, and from now on, do not sin anymore. How can you not keep his commandment? How can this woman, this adulterous woman, continue to sin after what she saw and heard? Such love from Jesus, such forgiveness. Jesus coming in between her and accusers. Jesus coming in between her and the sin. Jesus saying to her, do not sin anymore. Well, may it be so with us. When God says to us, do not sin. But if you fall into sin, I will be your advocate. I'll bring you back to the light. Let us close with the prayer that we prayed at the beginning, the same prayer. And I hope this prayer will be more meaningful now that we've gone through this passage. Let us pray. O Christ, our atoning sacrifice and our advocate, you died for our sins, and you defend us when we sin. Show us how we may keep your word, obey your commandments, abide in you, and walk as you walk, so that we may know you, so that the love of God may be perfected in us. For your name's sake, we pray. Amen.